Heavenly Father, it is our privilege again to come boldly in before you, Father, on this Sabbath day and ask your blessing and ask your Spirit and ask all that will make us your disciples and whiter than snow, Father, that we may use these things in your service. Be with us this day. May your Spirit be here. Be with Bill, Lord. Watch over him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. A lot of interesting stuff, folks. It's a privilege to be alive at the time we are. Whether we're going to see the Lord return or not in our lifetime, I don't know. But I do know these are the final movements. And to him, a moment is as an eternity, and an eternity is as a moment. So it's all to him. We have a part to play, either for or against. And I guess, basically, we've been looking at clothing. Let's go to Colossians 2. That's where we left off. Of course, when you're dealing with Paul, there's much to deal with. And I want to look at, we had read a few verses, but we spent a lot of time in Colossians 2:14 in blotting out the handwriting and ordinances that war against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. And we spent a great deal of time there. And I guess I was always confused as to why anybody was confused, because an ordinance and a commandment are two different things. Clearly, in our vernacular, clearly. And the only reason that people are confused is because of theologians, and they don't study themselves. And we will move on from there, because we spent a great deal of time on that last week, and I like that verse because it is a good way of showing that the moral law is still in effect. Just define the word ordinance. Anyhow, the interesting thing is, too, that is never brought out in that verse, that man's ordinances will kill you. Did you catch that? What does he say? What does Paul say? Did Paul know that on a personal level? Was that not part of his life when he was Saul? Were not the ordinances killing him? Because he's the same man that made the statement that I was alive, but then the law came and I died. So what was he living by? Ordinances, not God's law. Because an ordinance can only justify you in yourself. God's law does what? He said, too, it is a mirror. We don't like what we see when we look into it. But the ordinance, we can tweak it and change it and observe it and observe it and observe it. You see? And I tell you, those who live by ordinances and not God's law are legalists, not the other way around. Because the law of God is free conscience. Paul says, I choose to do all things are lawful for me, but I choose not to do all things because not all things build up. What is he saying? I have a great freedom of choice. When I was a priest, when I was part of the Sanhedrin, when I was a Pharisee, I had ordinances to live by. So I knew I was good because I was living up to what? The top of the sanctuary wall or to the top of men's ordinances? It's like we were talking about before. The man, and it's funny, sad but funny, who bought the indulgence from the guy selling them, robbed the guy of all the money that the priest got from the other people. Then when he went to court, what did he do? He held up the indulgence and said, oh, I've been forgiven for this. That's ordinances, folks. But you know, how much is that worth in God's, in the judgment right now? How much is that worth? It's sad. It's sad. So this being a study, and you know, it's funny because it's not used that much really anymore by the churches. It used to be a big deal. Oh, you see, the Sabbath was done away with. And it's interesting, they only ever pointed to the Sabbath. Anyhow, moving on. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Now, remember, this starts with dying in the baptism and being risen in Christ. But Jesus, here, he triumphed over principalities and powers and made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. What did he triumph over? What did Jesus triumph over at Calvary? This is what Paul is talking about, because he said, now death. Death, eternal death for the human race. Triumphed over all this, these things that the devil had set in place. Done. And it was a show, you see, publicly. Let no man therefore judge you in food or in drink or in respect of a holiday or a new moon or of a Sabbath days. Now it's interesting, a couple things in here. You'll notice something that is different about the word Sabbath. What is different about it? Small s, but plural. Plural. How many Sabbaths are spoken of in the commandments? One. Is it plural? This one's plural. What is the difference between hollow day and Sabbath? It's the same word. You see, in our vernacular, folks, today can be called a hollow day too. What does it mean? Holy day. They're talking clearly about feast days and this and that. And what Paul is saying, and let's back up a little bit here. Let no man judge you in meat or drink. Now, where in the Ten Commandments does it talk about food? Does it? Does it talk about it in the Fourth Commandment? Oh, let no man judge you in meat or drink, or in respect of a hollow day, a holy day. Feast of Tabernacles, was that a holy time? Pentecost, was that a holy day? Sunday was never a holy day. Never, ever, ever was it a holy day. So it's not referring to Sunday. However, there were many days that you had to eat and drink certain things on certain days. What were they called? What were those days? Those days. Feast days, Sabbath days. What does Sabbath mean? Rest. That's all. You see? Holy rest days. Days prescribed by ordinances. You see? It's simple. And you don't even have to know the Old Testament to really decipher it. That's just an excuse. Because an ordinance and a commandment are two different things. You cannot have an ordinance without a commandment. Why did I say that? An ordinance is a product of a commandment. You have to have a law first. Then ordinances follow on how to keep that law. Isn't that interesting? On how to respect that law. For instance, if there is no law in the state of Florida that says I have to stop for a stop sign, do I have to stop even though the stop sign is there? But there's no law that says you have to stop. There's a city ordinance that may say you have to stop, but there's no enforcing power behind that. What good is it? I can blow right through that stop sign and a cop can't do a thing because there's no commandment behind it. We have an ordinance, that's fine. But where's your power? Here, the Holy Spirit is saying these ordinances, they're done. Jesus was the ordinances, is the ordinances. You understand? So in the script itself, it is very clear what is being discussed. Prior to the coming of Christ, and why did he put in verse 15, why was Paul inspired to write verse 15? And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphant. Why did he put that in there? All these ordinances are done. The power that has been held over you by men is done. And I openly triumphed over it. There's no doubt that a man named Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross about 2,000 years ago by the Romans. Is there? History books will bear that out. Now, whether you believe or not, and where we're going with this is how you get your robes, your clothing washed. You see? The same way Joshua did back there in Zechariah 3. He triumphed. Boom, done. Those ordinances, they have been so perverted. They have been so infiltrated by Rome's people, if you will. They're done. They're over. Because remember, as we talked about last week, what did the children of Israel that came out of Egypt, what did they ask for at Mount Sinai? What did they ask for? To be saved in their sin, did they not? When they said, what is that? Chapter 20, I think it's verse 19. Oh, don't let God give us the law. He will consume us. We want you to do it, Moses. What is that saying? We're afraid to go into God's presence. Our sins are too much to overcome. You see? But if you minister to us, well, we can get away with stuff. That's what that's saying. So, it wasn't really the first intention that sin was overcome through man. Never was. However, that's what it turned into. Who became the judges of who had clean clothing and who didn't? The system did. Who was accepted, who wasn't. When you look back through the gospel and life of Jesus, there's a couple of instances where people were afraid of being kicked out of the synagogue, were they not? What did that mean? Why were they afraid of that? They couldn't have salvation, whatever that was. Whatever that was. And Jesus brought that situation to the surface with the blind man, did he not? When the parents came in, well, you ask him, we don't know. And what was recorded after that? Well, was this man blind all his life? And what did the parents say? We really don't know. He's of age. Ask him. Why did they say that? Because the writer, whether it was Matthew or John, I don't remember, said because they were what? Afraid of the principalities and powers of the time, of being kicked out. No chance at salvation. What did they believe as Seventh-day Adventists of the first century? Where was their hope? Where was their hope? Is it any different today? No, it's worse. It is because of ordinances. Not because of God's law. God's law is not the problem. God's law, yes, Paul is right, condemns me to death. That's what it does. 100%. That's all that can. But, I'm given a robe. Choose I to wear it. That will guarantee me eternal life. Through my own efforts, through the arm of flesh, or through faith in Christ. Interesting. That's why verse 15 is in there. He spoiled all this, so no man can judge you in these matters. If the Holy Spirit is leading you to do that, that doesn't mean to keep the feast days. That's not what Paul is saying here. But there was a lot of stuff going on. And having spoiled, let no man therefore judge you in meat and drink. Let me ask you this. Let's modernize that. Let's bring it up to today. Is there judging going on in the church about meat and drink? What did Jesus say? Eat my flesh, drink my blood. If you truly, in the sense that Jesus said, eat his flesh and drink his blood, will you be judged in the church? I'll guarantee you, you will. Was Mrs. White judged because of her diet? And I'm not talking about her human diet. I'm talking about her spiritual diet. You better believe it. So, what do you mean you're not reading this person? What do you mean you're not subscribing to that? Well, I read the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy. Oh, that's not enough. You can't take it literally. Have anybody here heard that? Has anybody here heard that? Oh, you need this commentary. And you know that the Seventh-day Adventist Bible commentaries are not all for Seventh-day Adventist authors. You know that, right? It's ecumenical. There's only one that is Seventh-day Adventist in nature and in theology. Do you know which one that is? 7A. What is that? Volume 7A of the commentaries? That is all Mrs. White's commentary. It's the only one you need. If you look up some of the things, issues and so on, you will get on many of them a Roman Catholic overview that comes out of the spiritual, of the common Bible commentaries. I know that's a bombshell. However, why do I say that? Because it all boiled down to church authority. Am I wrong, Rodney? You've read them. Everything comes back to church authority. Really, Mrs. White's commentaries do not. They come back to heavenly authority. Or in respect to holy day, or a new moon, or a Sabbath day. Are we, when I say we, people who are truly trying to keep the Sabbath, are we judged for that? That we're doing it wrong? How many people have come here and told us we're breaking the Sabbath? Was Jesus judged on these issues, by the way? Was he? How many times? Oh, you're eating and drinking with whom? Your disciples are picking food and then they're working on the Sabbath. You're breaking the Sabbath, you see? Yeah. We're working, we're washing dishes, we're doing this, we're doing that. This was all addressed and we were warned that this would be a problem. Do you know that Mrs. White had up to 33 people at her table on a Sabbath afternoon? You don't think there was some working going on there? You better think again. What did Jesus say? Your priests in the temple break your very rules every Sabbath. What is the motive? You see, that's the problem. That's what's being spoken of here. Let no man judge you in meat or drink. And by the way, that word meat, what does it mean, folks? Food. Food. Or in drink or in respect of a holiday. As for me, I want to eat Christ's flesh and drink his blood. I don't know about you. That's the only way I'll know what holidays to keep or not keep. Are we judged for not keeping Christmas and Easter as Christians? As Seventh-day Adventist Christians? Yes, we are. You see? So these words weren't just for this first century, were they? They're more relevant now than they were then. You know why? Because the devil has used them deceptively, as he always, mixing a little truth in, you see. He goes on to say, verse 17, which are shadows of things to come. What are these holidays? These Sabbath days? This food, this drink, the ordinances were shadows, which are a shadow of things to come. But the body is of Christ. What body? The reality of Seventh-day Adventism is Christ. All these things are worthless. They're deadly. And they're done away with. Look, if you want to do this or do that, doesn't mean you can go out and eat all the hamburgers and barbecued ribs you want. That's not what's being said here, because that's been thrown in my face too. Because that is so far out of context, it's pathetic. And that's a dishonest person that says that. And I'm not talking about the masses. I'm talking about the Sabbath school teachers, the Sunday school teachers, the preachers who say that. They're being very dishonest because the context is not that, is it? Where you go to dine and what you eat, that's not what's being spoken of here. This is spiritual consumption for what? Eternal life. That's what this is. And Paul says, which is a shadow. All these things were just, what does it mean it's a shadow of this? He was the Lamb. He was the Feast of Tabernacles. He is the day of Pentecost, etc., 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 etc. Is it wrong to think of these things? No, because why? If you understand them, what will you understand? That. But after that, to go out and practice them, what are you doing? Denying that. Saying it never happened. They're a shadow of things to come. But the body, that word, that means the reality is Christ. Forget those things. Forget them as far as having any salvational value in practicing them. Understanding them is everything. What excuse then would the Jews have had to reject their Savior? They were Christian people, were they not? The very practice of these things, the day of Passover and all of it, would call them to Christianity, to Christ. So this idea that they weren't Christian is ridiculous. Makes no sense, does it? But we have these guys, the devil, divide and conquer. You see? And I tell you, even today, the Jews are still waiting for the coming of Messiah. Well, do you believe that Christ? Well, yeah, but then that makes you a Christian. Am I wrong? So why do you have this whole separate set of rules? You better be careful how you proceed at that point. Because what happens for somebody who calls them a Christian and doesn't act like one or live like one? See, the Lord only has two categories. What are they? Sheep and goats, left and right, the saved and the unsaved. How many categories do we have? We have theology here that is being ecumenism says what? Oh, it doesn't matter. They all lead to God. Is that what the scripture says? Isn't that interesting? There's only one way to get the wedding garment, you see. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, introducing into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. It doesn't, there is no way to get to God except what? Through Christ. Him and him crucified. That is what Paul is saying here. Because you remember, Paul had a real bad experience on Mars Hill, did he not? Did he not go to argue these things? And was he not successful in arguing his arguments? Yes, he was. Successful in the fact that, he's a pretty learned man. But did they come away seeing Christ and him crucified? No. So what did he say? I will never do that again. I will only preach Christ and him crucified. That's all this is. You're dead in your sins. You're dead in your trespasses. That's how he starts up here. You're dead in your sins. You're dead in your philosophies. In verse 8, he warns, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophies and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. The two do not mix. The two do not mix. You cannot have both. You either have Christ and him crucified, or you have men's traditions and ways, which is ultimately what? The devil's ways. You can't have both. He said, don't be spoiled by these things. Interesting. So, all you ecumenical Christians, be careful, because everything in these few verses you're flying in the face of. Everything that's in here. Everything you believe. Oh, this is okay, and that's okay. You can believe this, and you can... Paul's saying you can't. There's only one thing. The reality is Christ. He said here that he spoiled these things. He destroyed these things. He debunked these things publicly. Isn't that what he's saying? It's amazing to me how plain and simple it is and how it gets twisted and turned. It's pretty amazing. Mrs. White says, through his sacrifice, human beings may reach the high ideal set before them. And here at last, the words, ye are complete in him. Not having your own righteousness, but the righteousness that he wrought out for you. Your imperfection is no longer seen. You are clothed with the robe of Christ's perfection. So you have a clean robe given you. Hear what she says? Through his sacrifice, human beings may reach the high ideal set before them. Not through anything else, folks. Not through your local church programs. Not through your teachers, your preacher's teachings. The evangelists say so. Not through any of that. Not through theologies. Paul says, beware of those things. No, one thing. Christ and him crucified. How does your robe get? First of all, how do you get the robe? Through Christ and him crucified. It's white, spotless. How do you keep it clean? Well, let's look at it. I want to go to Matthew 27, 51. You know, the interesting thing is, if you believe the one verse that's taken so out of context here that the law is nailed to the cross, then the rest of the chapter is garbage. The rest of the chapter means nothing. It is totally contrary to what the rest of the chapter is. Because what did Jesus say? Paul says in verse 17, the reality is Christ. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll do what? However, you want me to believe that here Paul is saying that that's not true. If you believe that the law was done away with, then you've already been spoiled by philosophies and vain deceits and traditions of men. You believe that Jesus did not publicly put all this stuff away. You see, what is the purpose of him dying? To do away with the law? Oh, okay. So, to exalt sin. Because this very same man said, I was alive. When the law came, what happened? I died. So then if you believe that that means that, you believe that Jesus at Calvary immortalized sin. It's ridiculous. A 10-year-old could understand that. Maybe even younger. That, right there, if you believe that, immortalized sin forever. That's who wants you to believe that? Who preached that, Kody? Ergo Sabbath school? Who preached that? You can sin and live forever. So it is the same thing. It is so ridiculous. Where were we going? Matthew 27:51. Says here, and behold, the veil of the temple was ripped in two from top to bottom. And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. Gee, what occasion might this have been? Oh, that's at Jesus' death. When did he die? When he was on Calvary. So what does this have to do with what we're talking about? By the rending of the veil, Mrs. White says, of the temple, God said, I can no longer reveal my presence in the most holy place. A new and living way before which there hangs no veil is offered to all. No longer need sinful, sorrowing humanity wait the coming of the high priest, type met antitype, in the death of the Son of God. The Lamb of God had been offered as a sacrifice. It was as if the voice had said to the worshipers, there is now an end to all sacrifices and offerings. Everything that we attempt to do without Jesus woven into it is what? Garbage. It's deception, and its end's going to lead where? We have to have the wedding garment. We must have the wedding garment. No ifs, ands, or buts. There is no exception. No longer, and that's a pretty powerful statement she makes there, folks. No longer will his presence be where? In the temple. What does that mean? What does that mean? It's over with. It's done. So what authority on earth can man claim over God's salvation? None. See, what was undone, what was done at Sinai. Oh, Moses, no. God's got to go away. Let him go back up on the mountain. We want you to give us the law. We want you to be our priest. You see? That was undone there, was it not? No more. Done. That system didn't work. Not because the system was imperfect, because who was imperfect? Man. What did he do? He sought to do what he does with everything. Control, authority, power, money, gain. But you see, now with the temple empty of deity, how could man control it? So what did the Jews do, folks? What did they do? They sewed the veil up. Oh, we're going to keep right on going. Doesn't mean anything. Could you say they made their own clothing at that point? What's the difference between what they did and Adam and Eve did? Well, Adam and Eve recognized that they were naked. They didn't. They just felt that they got ripped off. No pun intended. You see? Do we do that in our lives? Are we doing that with our lives? Oh, it's easy to throw this responsibility of salvation onto somebody else, isn't it? But you see, the reality, folks, is Christ, period. Him and him crucified. That's the reality. Now, it became very personal at this point. It always was. Ask Abraham, he'll tell you. Ask Moses, ask Adam, ask Eve. It was always very personal. Always custom fit. You see? Let's go to Ephesians 2, 14 through 18. Back the other way. Ephesians 2 says, for he is our peace who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition. What wall would that be? Between us, it says. The temple, the veil was ripped. What did that do in the temple? Ephesians 2, Nellie, verse 14. What did that happen in the temple when the veil was ripped? The two became one, did they not? He broke down the middle wall of partition. Between who and who? Where was that? Between us and God. You don't need an intermediate anymore on earth. So what intermediate do we have? Jesus Christ, the Melchizedek priesthood, which always has been there. He broke down the wall of partition. That's the ripping of the veil. Having abolished in the flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances. What does that mean? For to make in himself of two one new man, so making peace. In other words, the carrying out of the ordinances, that's what it means. That's done away with. You don't have to come to the Father through these things. That's all gone. Now it is direct communication. You see? Oh, use the word commandment. No. The law of commandments where? In other words, the carrying out, the commands of the ordinances. You have to do this, you can't touch this, you can't taste that, you can't do this, you can't do that. Not the Ten Commandments. Because then the rest of that verse makes no sense. For to make in himself of two one new man, so making peace. How can we get rid of God's commandments and then make peace with God? Does that make sense? Of course not. We don't have to carry these. You don't have to listen to these so-called leaders. You don't have to do what they say. Remember, Jesus said something to the woman at the well. He said, salvation is with the Jews. Not to the woman at the well, but to the people. He said, listen to the Pharisees. Do what they say, but don't do as they do, because they know what to do. What was he referring to? And the woman at the well. Oh, these ordinances, they must be carried out at this time. But then he also said to the woman at the well, but the day is coming when what? That worship will no longer be. He was calling the mind to these things. All that stuff will be done away with. So the inference, when he said, listen to what the Pharisees tell you and do it, but don't do as they do, those things don't make you clean because they do those things. Isn't that interesting? However, if you do them, and not as the Pharisees do, but in truth and spirit, what will their minds be led to? Christ and him crucified. Which, by the way, will be done away with, not him and the ordinances. The commandments in the ordinances, nobody has to tell you have to do them anymore. Doesn't it say that in Jeremiah, the day will come when no man will teach another? I will write my law upon your mind and heart. Isn't that what it says in Jeremiah? Well, it also says that in the New Testament, does it not? Did not Paul echo those words in Hebrews? You see? So balance that out. There is nothing we can do to be saved. That's what he's saying. The commandments and the ordinances. There is nobody that can save you other than Jesus Christ and him crucified. Having, in verse 15, abolished in the flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of two one new man, so making peace. That's it. And that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you, which was afar off, and to them that were near, the Jews. He came and he preached this message to everybody. Those that were far off, who would that be? The Gentiles. Did the Jews have anything to do with the Gentiles? They didn't have anything to do with their own people, the Samaritans. But then those who were near, the so-called people of God, the Jews. So this is for everybody. This is for all. Once and for all. This stuff is done with. The two shall become one. Pretty interesting stuff. pretty interesting stuff. Now, how do we know all these things? Well, gee, you know, if there's no church that has this kind of authority, how do I know? Who's going to teach me? How will I learn? I need these things, really? Well, I find it interesting that just before Jesus was crucified, he spent some time in the upper room with some guys. And he said some things. But you know what? It's interesting because one topic kept coming up, which Seventh-day Adventists don't want to acknowledge. Let's go to John. One topic kept coming up. Let's go to the book of John. Let's go to chapter 14. Now we know that this is all of us very well, the situation in the upper room just before his crucifixion, John 14, 15. We all know this verse very well. If you love me, you keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, who the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will comfort you. Who's he talking about? He's going to send the Holy Spirit. For what purpose here? And it's interesting, he calls him the comforter. Do you know that that word comforter is synonymous with mediator? Isn't that interesting? And you'll also notice how many times in those couple of verses is the word he used. Look at it. One. Yes. One. A word him. Two. Him. Three. He. Four. Wow. Five up there. So, who's the he? Did Jesus not know what he was saying? Was Jesus not speaking accurately? Was he making mistakes? Because the last time I looked, what does he mean? A person. Not a thing, because that would be the word you would use. Oh, but, you know, that's English, and it was written in Greek, but it really should have been written in Hebrew. Trace it back. It's the exact same word. And by the way, the word comforter drives it home. It's a very interesting word. It's not used too many other places in the Bible. That particular meaning for comforter. So here in chapter 14 of his time he's spending alone with the disciples, he brings up the Holy Spirit. That John records. And then we go over to the next chapter. And what do we see? Jesus also says, by the way, there's a condition for receiving the Comforter. What is it? What is it? You have to keep the commandments. Can we keep the commandments in our own strength? She says here, we are not to serve God as if we were not human, but we are to serve him in the nature we have that has been redeemed by the Son of God. Wow. Isn't that interesting? Through the righteousness of Christ, we shall stand before God, pardoned, and as though we had never sinned. Does that bring to mind anybody in the Bible that we've been talking about recently? How about Joshua standing before the throne of God? He was trying to serve in his human nature. Wasn't working, was it? What were his clothing as? Filthy rags. But then, what happened? He was given Christ's righteousness. Folks, his robe was washed in what? Blood of the Lamb. Oh, but wait a minute. Jesus wasn't crucified yet, really? He wasn't? Not physically, but the deal was made. I saw the Lamb that was what? Slain. It didn't say, John did not say crucified yet. However, the deal was made before Lucifer was made, as far as I'm concerned, because they knew what the problem was. So they had the solution. By the way, if the Holy Spirit is not involved, you cannot have this robe. You will be deceived. If it were possible, the very elect would be deceived. What does that statement mean? I've heard all kinds of stuff. Oh, the elect will be deceived. It says, if it were possible, meaning it is impossible for the very elect to be deceived. Who are the very elect? Those who have the wedding garment and the Holy Spirit. What keeps them from being deceived? The Holy Spirit. Him and Him alone. Here, folks, is how the robe gets cleaned. I just read it. We will never gain strength in considering what we might do if we were angels. We are to turn in faith to Jesus Christ and show our love to God through obedience to His commandments. We are given the wedding garment, it's washed clean, as if we never left heaven. But then what do we have to do? Keep it clean. How? How do I know how to keep His commandments? Because I was just said here that you can't do it in your own strength. Well, therein comes the Holy Spirit. Does Jesus back this up? Well, as we were looking at, that is in the Study Bible, Nellie, and it was Manuscripts 1, 1892 it came out of. But that's under verse 15 in the Study Bible of John. 14:15. Under that verse. So then we go over and we see, of course, Jesus in verse 15 goes into great detail about keeping whose commandments, by the way? Whose? His or His Father's? They're not for Him to nail to the cross, are they? And who nailed Jesus to the cross? His Father. Who resurrected Him? His Father. So what right has He to do away with His Father's commandments? You see what I mean? They put a wedge between, the devil's very clever, between Jesus and the Father. Paul says He raised Him from the dead. Who's He and who's the Him? Jesus said, I always do my Father's will. Jesus says here in 15, if you abide in me, in verse 7 of chapter 15, John, if you abide in me and my word abides in you, you shall ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. Well, here you see righteousness and faith, works and faith combined in that one statement. Why is there a question about it? If you're righteous, what are you going to do? You're going to bear much fruit. If you have the wedding garment on, you're going to bear much fruit. If the Holy Spirit is in you, you can't help but bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue you in my love. If you keep my commandments, you also abide in my love, even as I have kept whose? My Father's commandments, and abide in His love. These things I have spoken unto you, that joy may remain in you, and that you might be fulfilled. So He says, if you keep my commandments, well, what commandments are they? The law of ordinances that Paul's talking about? No. He says, I've kept my Father's commandments. They're the one and the same. So he goes on, and now we go to chapter 16. And what do we see? How do we do all this? The Holy Spirit, again, chapter 16, verse 5. But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you ask me, where do you go? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. In other words, good. It's very good for you. For if I do not go away, the Comforter, again, that word is synonymous with mediator, will not come to you, but if I depart, I will send him. And when he, again, here's that word he, is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. How do we know if we're walking in God's will? How do we know that? The Holy Spirit will let us know. We will see the commandments clearly and understand if we're living up to them. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and see you no more. The law of ordinances is done away with. You see? Of righteousness, I give you the robe. I go away to the Father. What's he saying? I'm now the mediator up there. It is you will be judged as I am judged of righteousness. Provided you do what? Well, of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. It was an open spectacle to the whole world that Christ vanquished eternal death. Lucifer was judged. I have yet, go to my Father. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged, I have yet many things to tell you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, in other words, well, it is when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you the things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. Who will teach us of these things? No man shall teach another. I shall write my laws upon your mind and upon your actions. How? Through what medium? The Holy Spirit. It is impossible to be deceived if we have the Holy Spirit. It is impossible to have dirty robes on if the Holy Spirit is walking with us. He can't. We're given a clean robe as if we never left heaven. How do we? I read Mrs. White told us how our robes are washed in the blood of the Lamb. Don't let any man tell you what theology you should follow, what you should eat or drink. Don't let any man tell you how to keep the Sabbath. That's up to me, not me personally, but to Jesus. He was constantly accused of breaking the Sabbath. And by the way, how will you know these things? The Holy Spirit's going to tell you. It's that simple. Direct communication, because the veil was ripped in two. You see? No longer a man mediating, but the Melchizedek priest, which was the Comforter and is Jesus Christ. Pretty simple, isn't it? We have a great, great gift of choice, but it is also a great burden. We don't want that. We want to go on and be told, hey, you can do what you want. You don't tell us this, God. Give us a man to tell us this. We haven't changed. We've gotten worse. Give us a system, a church, a name. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you for, again, the simplicity of your word. And, Father, the agencies that you have put in place, so many, to see to it that we do not fall. Help us to accept our garment, our wedding robe. Put it on and go forth triumphant and at peace, Father, not with the world, with you. Because nobody that wears that robe will be at peace with this world. Help us, Lord, to have an urgency to put an end to this down here and do all we can and to reach the unreachable, Father. May your Holy Spirit reign supreme. In Jesus' name we pray.